Good evening and welcome to Pastoral Talks. Again, I'll be your host, Dr. Ken. With me as always is the doctor himself, Dr. Glenn. And of course, our special guest is the beautiful Apostle April. Let us begin. I'm pressed for time and I want to get this thought out. What do we do? How do we avoid sharing a vision? In other words, it's an antidote for 1,000 arguments. What do I mean? We talk about later on in the program, a vision. We're going to talk about relationships. And I asked the two experts that have been married for years about sharing this vision with, whether it be if you're just friendships or you're dating or if you're married, how do you avoid the arguments? And sometimes a powerful thing happens when you let go of your vision of you and grab a hold of God's vision of you. So let us begin. I'll start with Dr. G himself. The reason that business creates policy and procedures to be able to make 1,000 decisions at one time. Otherwise, we have to make a decision about each new circumstances each day. So in many ways, clarifying the vision is doing the same thing in your relationship. There is power in precision to guidelines of priority. Your thought, Dr. G.
I think the biggest, most profound mistake that people make in marriage is the pre-marriage. I remember Dr. James Dobson said this. You got to go in with your eyes wide open, and once you get married, you got to close your eyes. We're not asking the right questions. We're so caught up in going to the movies and,
yes,
you know, hanging out and having sex and drinking and partying and, oh, this is the person for me. And the problem that we're having is that we're not having those honest conversations before we decide to get on our knee and say, will you marry me? At the end of the day, it's all about will. And when a man gets on his knee and he asks a woman, will you marry me? She has an option to say yes or no. So it's really about the woman and her perspective on a relationship than it is about the man.
That's good.
So we have to be really careful as women, first of all, in making sure that the Bible says he who finds a wife findeth a good thing. And watch this. And obtains favor with the Lord. So women, you are the favor that is going to be endowed on the man.
Wow.
So you have to be careful with who you marry. Men, we have to be cognizant, but we don't have to be careful. Women, you have to be extremely careful with who you marry because you're going to enhance his life. So if he's if he's lazy, if he's apathetic, and you marry him, you're not going to make him become a worker. You're going to give him more of what he already is. So you got to be careful with that. And then men, we have to ask the right questions. Stop being timid about asking questions. If you feel in your heart that you need a woman that's going to provide for you as far as cleaning and cooking and things like that, you need to ask those questions up front so you don't waste your time and then have to go to divorce court all because you failed to ask questions that if you would have known in the beginning, you would have never made those decisions to do that.
Good word, Dr. J. Just amazing how just every subject you're an expert. Thank you. The word division is made up of two parts. I thought that was very interesting. Instead of vision, it's division. The prefix di means two, so the word division means two visions. The reason many marriages or friendships or dating is in conflict all the time is they have two different versions.
Absolutely.
And, of course, the apostle, let's bring her in for as the theologian. It says in Luke 11:17 tells us, any kingdom divided against itself will be ruined. A house divided itself will fail. So, apostle to you, any kingdom divided against itself. In other words, most couples don't consciously think about this, but the greatest hope for our future is if we can start here and now, we continue to coexist with two visions, our house will reap what we sow. But when we buy and share a vision, in other words, we buy into the vision that there's one vision, and that's preceding 1,000 decisions that we'll ever make. Your thought on how we do that?
It's unity. We have to come into agreement. First of all, like Dr. Glenn said, we have to first understand what we are marrying. You have to be equally yoked. If you know that the man or woman that you are interested in is not of God, that's the first red flag. You cannot go into the marriage thinking that you can change anyone, because the only thing it's going to do is change your life, and you're going to be unhappy, and then you're going to be stuck. So we want to first make sure that we're making the right decision. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 11:9 that the woman was made for the man. The man was not made for the woman. Mm. So when it comes to that particular chat or scripture, we have to identify that with that he that find a wife find it a good thing and obtain favor with the Lord is coincide, is together. So the man is looking at, he don't have to. It's the woman who have the desire to want, to need, to have that man with. So we have to come into the place of unity, agreement, and I always recommend pre-counseling before marriage. Because you never know what you are getting into. It takes a lifetime to know a partner.
That's good.
I'm still learning my husband. There are still things that is within our life. We'd be like, well, what? When did you start doing that? So you have to make sure, are you ready to handle that? Are you ready to have that type of responsibility in your life? Do you want to deal with that? So these are questions. Do you have child support? Do you have kids? Or do you have a job? You have to ask these questions, because once you get into the marriage, and then the man, it's like that saying, why buy the cow when you can get the milk for free? So we want to make sure that we are equally yoked when we get into relationships.
That's a great word. So vision directs, Dr. Glenn, in an age when we use all of our electronic devices, I wonder if some of the age group ever put the devices down to see who they're engaged with, but it's hard to remember the long, pain-taking path that navigates that took help people to find their way. In other words, historically, navigation has included depending on certain objects like the sun, the moon, the stars. That's why I said the sun became the star. And earlier, sun, of course, is the star, but I was talking about Dr. Glenn being the Son of God as the star of vision, because of his gifts in his preaching, his teaching, his apostolic gifting, of course, his prophetic words that he gives. For thousands of years, the navigation, the sailors, the astronomers used this North Star. So if we're really going true north and relying on and giving the same sense of direction, don't you think, Dr. Glenn, that this makes sense to fix the point for navigation? In other words, vision gives a sense of our true north. It doesn't mean every decision is based on the predetermined standard, but at least we have a vision to start it out. Your thought?
Absolutely, absolutely. And it goes back to what I was talking about, is talking about vision and talking about with the person that you're courting. And I love that word courting, because it's like you're putting them on trial. Engagement ring doesn't mean that I'm going to marry you. It just means I'm committed to being serious about looking at marrying you. This is the one that I am choosing to want to partner with. That everything that we've talked about, everything that we've discussed, it's right up my alley. And this is somebody I can potentially see myself living the rest of my life with. So with that being said, without vision, the Bible tells us this. Without vision, God says that my people perish. In your marriage, if there is no vision, or if the vision is one-sided, the marriage will fail. It will not work. Why? Because it's supposed to be the two coming together as one. If I'm talking about, let's say to my wife, if I'm telling her, oh, I'm going to be a rapper. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to be a rapper. I'm going to rap for the rest of my life. She has to make the decision on, if I never change, if I don't change today, if I keep pursuing being a rapper for the next 50 years, she has to ask herself this very hard question. Am I okay with him the way he is right now? If he never changes, am I okay with him? And I think this is a question that we miss when it comes to marriage, because when there's no vision, you're just out there shooting and you got all these wonderful dreams, but your dreams don't really mean nothing. They're empty promises. And so many women end up in these empty promising situations because women have been meant to help. And that is what helped meet the need of the vision. Hey, I'm going here and I need you to support. I need you to help. I need you to uplift. I need you to pray. I need you. And the woman is so excited about being a partner and partnering with somebody, but they're not part. You got to remember, you're not partnering just with the person.
That's good. That's really good.
You're partnering with the vision. And if they have no vision, women, you should be asking this very important question. What's the vision? Where's our North Star? When I was in the military, I did not know where we were going half of the time. I was serving in the U.S. Navy. I didn't know where we were going after the time. But what I knew was the vision. And what was the vision? Is that if something came up, I knew exactly what position I had to have. And in most of our relationships, we don't have that. Things happen.
We have wars right now that are going on across the planet that some of us don't even know about. But there are wars that happen in relationships, and you're not prepared for them. If you have a financial situation, me and my wife have a mechanism that if this happens, this is how we're going to line this up. We're going to talk about it. We're going to sit down and look at our bills. We're going to organize this. Or if we make a decision where we're going to have to do something, we have to make sure that we're talking about vision. The relationship, yeah, the sex might be great, and yes, the, you know, we've had some great times, but I need to talk to you about how we're going to get through the hard times, because love is not a word that, I mean, we throw it around so lightly,
amen,
Dr. King,
amen.
But it's a word that it's really not expressed until it's exposed. What does that mean? When you need it. Love is a word that has to be put under pressure before it really makes sense to you and I. So I just want to encourage you that if you're single, if you're divorced, or, I mean, whatever the case, even if you're married right now and your relationship is on the rocks, it's time to get vision. Vision, vision, vision. If you don't, if you're not married, and I know I'm spending a little bit of time on this because it's so important,
no, it's good.
What you said, Dr. Ken, about focusing on vision. Without a vision, you're just planning to fail. When situations come, you're not going to be prepared for them. When your kids start acting up, you're not going to be prepared. You're going to want to beat them, and she's going to want to love on them, and you're going to be arguing, why I'm trying to discipline them. Well, I know you're trying to discipline them, but I'm trying to love him. You're being too harsh with him. And you're going to have all these different situations where if you would have just had vision in the beginning, before the kids even were even thought of being born, then you would have something to work with. If I'm a drug addict and she doesn't want to be with the drug addict, she'll tell me that, like, I'm sorry, this isn't going to work. Whatever the case may be, you got to talk about real stuff.
Wow,
that North
good.
Star, that was such a good point, Dr. Ken. You got to have that North Star. This is what I want. And that's what Apostle April will tell you. She wrote out what she wanted her husband to be. And I just so happened to be everything, but she didn't put taller. So she missed that part. Sorry, babe. But she wrote out the vision. So that way when the decoy came, she was able to recognize it and say, that's not it. The only reason why she was able to do that, because she had vision. Stop making it about how buff the guy is. Stop making it about how much money he has or what kind of
car
he drives. Stop making it about how beautiful her body is shaped. Stop making it about how beautiful she can sing. Make it about, does she love God? Does he have a relationship with God? Does he pay his tithes? You know, make it about stuff that's really important. And the other stuff will come. The Bible says, seek ye first the kingdom. And that even comes to your spouse. When you seek ye first the kingdom with your spouse, then all of the other things will be added. Because if they love God, then they're going to love you.
Good word, sir. If you're ever near Vision TV, and we're here in Westminster, I encourage you to come out on Monday. They're here every Monday. They're powerful teaching, powerful counseling sessions. At Vision Source, we have a strong sense that we're a purpose for our marriage, but it hasn't been revealed to us yet. Now, Apostle, to you. So we know God's vision is there, but we haven't seen it yet. We know how to get a clear vision of revelation, but it's still not clear. What do we do?
Well, when it comes to relationship, if it's not clear, then leave it alone.
Mm-hmm.
The end. When it comes to seeing, or you praying and asking God, okay, God, show me who I'm supposed to marry. First of all, I believe, and this is just my own belief, that God have better things to do than to show you who your mate is. He give you the wisdom, the characteristics of the Holy Spirit, to be able to make those decisions to know if that is a person for you, because you are the one that's going to be attracted to that person. Now, don't get me wrong. God do sometimes line people up, but at the same time, He don't pick the color of your car. He don't tell you what other socks to put on. He don't tell you that, you know, different, like, go grocery shopping or doing this. Those are things that you can make self-man decisions. When it comes to relationship, you got to seek God first and ask him, Glenn said, I wrote it out. I was very specific. I knew what I wanted. I knew I needed somebody to help me raise my kids because I had a boy. And I knew I needed a man figure in my home. So I was very specific in the detail of what I wanted in a husband. So until that, and I kept it in my Bible. As I prayed that writing, that's what I wrote down. I prayed it and I made it manifest because I believed that God was going to bring that to me. But I had a vision of what I wanted. God didn't give me the vision of what I wanted. So I knew what I was looking for in a husband. So when it talks about looking for a husband, you first got to be right. Wife, woman, gotta be right. You cannot just keep wanting a husband and your life is a disaster. You got your history following you on your back. You gotta get your life right first. What does that mean? You gotta go into the Word of God You got to take the time to separate yourself. No more club hopping. No more potty popping. You got to go and sit yourself before God and just say, okay, this is now, I need to build this relationship first so I know that when my husband come, then I will be right. You got to go out of that Proverbs 31 woman. That is a woman that will really put an alignment of what a man need to support him. The Proverbs 31 woman talks about how she wake up before the house, how she get things prepared before the house, how she always in prayer for her husband and for her children. Right. And even though she didn't have a job, she still had ways to make money. How? By doing a garden and then going out and selling those things so she would be able to bring money into the house the way that she knew how. The Bible says, and actually Proverbs 31 and 25, it says that she smile upon the future and that the words that come out of her mouth is wisdom, and that she releases soft teaching. What does that mean? That she smiles upon the future. That means that God is showing her a vision, that she already see what is coming, that she already see what is ahead, and she's smiling upon it because she's in agreement with what God is showing her. And then she released that wisdom to her family, and she actually teaches them on what God has told her. So you have to be in alignment with God first before you can even supply or support or take care of your husband. Because if you don't know how to do that, then you are not going to be successful as a wife. You got to be able to know who you are first in God to be able to know how to love your husband, because you got to first love yourself.
Amen. Good point. I want to bring 3 points back. Well done, Apostle. First off, it's very good. We'd be robots if we heard every word from God. He was telling us what to do 24 hours a day. I agree with her 1,000%. I always hear, oh, but God told me this. God, did he? Now, if we know that in John 2:7 or Luke 5:5, it says one word from God will change your life, then if he spoke, he's meek. The word says he's meek in spirit, so therefore he doesn't talk that much. The words are weighty, so what he says, it makes sense. It moves mountains. It changes lives. Here's the second point that I thought she said. She knew the scripture, which is rare, but it was very well done. All of a sudden, she's a theologian. Last show, she couldn't remember anything, and now all of a sudden, she's... And by the way, Joe Olstein's taken. That's why Glenn was available. But my final point, and I didn't mean to get carried away on that thought, but Paul writes in Ephesians, and I'm getting spiritual here because I'm reading it, Dr. G, to you, at least we have somebody that's spiritual and really knows the word, Dr. Glenn. Thank God he brings us the balance. It's Ephesians 1, 8 through 9. It says, with all wisdom and understanding, God made known and revealed to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which the purpose in Christ. So he reveals to his friends, we found out the last show that we're friends of God, John 15:15, and we found out that Dr. Glenn does know the answer. So Dr. G, take it away.
So I think that the scripture is probably the best place to find guidance. I think it's the best place to find rest. I think it's the best place to find protection.
Good.
So I'm going to read for you Galatians chapter 6, verse 4. It says these words, pay careful attention to your own work. To your own work. The amazing thing about marriage is that it's not really about marriage, it's about singleness. It's about you as a person coming into a relationship or a covenant with another person. And you have to make sure that you are okay. You have to make sure that you've allowed yourself time to get over that past relationship. You have to allow yourself time to heal. The heart, and I said this before, Dr. Ken, heart is the only thing that a surgeon can't bring a healing to. There is no pill. I don't care how many doctors you go to or what type of psychiatrist you go to. The only thing that could truly heal your heart is the word of God. There is no science. They can't figure out. And, you know, some might even say time is what heals. But you got to allow yourself to be taken care of. Pay careful attention to your own work. For then you will get the satisfaction of a job well done, and you won't need to compare yourself to anyone else. The problem that a lot of us are facing, to answer your question, Dr. Ken, is that we have become, and I'm addicted, I'm not addicted to this, but I used to be addicted to this, was people pleasing.
That's good.
And sometimes we get in relationships and we think that it's of God if we're trying to please the other person. But that's not really what God has called you to do, is to be a people pleaser. Now, Paul himself said that I am everything to everyone, but he didn't mean that he goes around people-pleasing. And sometimes in relationships, we like to interpret us showing our spouse love, even when they're treating us bad. We like to interpret that as, oh, I'm just going to continue to love them. No, you can't allow people to abuse you. That's what God does not want you to do. That's the whole reason why he sent Jesus, because we're being abused by the enemy. So he's wanting us to get to a point in our lives where we understand that it's not about being a people pleaser. It's about knowing yourself, having your own identity, and moving forward. April is my wife, and we've been married for 13 years now. We've been together for 13 years, I'm sorry. But at the end of the day, I can't worry about her. I have to worry about my Father's business. She has to come into alignment with the Word of God. I can't worry about, you know, being nervous about going to church because she might be sleeping around with somebody else. I can't worry about, you know, who is she texting. She'll tell you to this day, I have never said, give me your phone, let me see who you talk to. And she's never done that to me. It's because we are confident in ourselves. If something's going on, it's going to come out. So why worry about that? Why stress yourself? Why take yourself off of the focus of what God has called you to be? Don't worry about the things of this world. Focus on the kingdom. And in the kingdom, there is no relationships where you have to sit there and worry about. In the kingdom of heaven, all you're going to do is focus on the purpose. You're going to focus on worshiping. There's no sickness. There's no envy. There's no jealousy. There's none of that stuff. So we have to make sure that we focus on the kingdom and allow God to line up everything else in our lives. I've been married before. This isn't my first marriage. It fell apart. And I believe that it was all because I wasn't following the kingdom. I made my wife my God, and it ended up destroying my relationship.
Now we see the flaw. We need 2 hours for him to go on. So, but the vision, I'm closing with this, and this is it, because we're running out of time. The vision we're recommending in marriage is a joint vision that's not only revealed in prayer, but the marriage vision isn't the handcrafted and brainstorm meetings. A marriage vision is calling deliverance by the Lord. So, vision is revealed through scriptures, not a small group or disciples sitting around brainstorming. No, it starts with people desperately seeking God, pursuing his persistence, and until the Lord delivers. Acts 1 and 2 tells us Jesus, how he's crucified, resurrected, but through that he said he would send the gift that God promised, which is the Holy Spirit. So after 10 days, they joined together constantly in prayer, Acts 1:14. The disciples, 10 days, they detox from their personal wants and individual plans. This is what Apostle April is going to say anyway. Persistent in prayer and fasting, asking the Lord for instructions, clarifying step by step. On the 10th day, the day of Pentecost, they saw a vision, tongues of fire in their heads. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts 2, 3, 4. You want to pray us out with 1 minute or less?
Good word. That's a good word. We're going to close in just prayer of everything that has been spoken tonight, that it will resonate with your spirit. And if you feel that this is something that you want to change in your life, then let God move in your life tonight. Father God, we just thank you for the spoken word that went forth tonight, Father God. And I just pray for the woman, Father, and the man, Lord, that they will come together equally, yoke, Father, under the umbrella of your spirit, that they will seek you first, Father God, the kingdom, Father God, and everything else they are looking for is going to be added unto them. But Father, I pray that their spirit be free, that they will look for you, Father, and have the spirit of repentance upon them, God, that they will be able to seek you like never before, and every answer, Father, to their question will be answered. Father, and I pray that they find the right male and partner for them, Lord God, to be able to come together in a unit, Father, powerful, Father, working in the kingdom of God, and let your spirit rest upon their homes, their hearts, and their minds. And we just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Until next week, I'm Dr. Ken, of course, the apostle. With us, as always, is Dr. G. We'll see you on Pastor's Talk. Thanks for watching.